Hello and welcome to virtual worship with the Congregational Church of Brookfield. We are an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ, so we want you to know that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. The church season of Advent begins today, and with it, a new church year. As we light today the candle of hope, we remember the light of Christ, which will be coming soon. That holy light from the Gospel according to John still promises to shine eternally through our darkness. But even if COVID conditions mean you will lift up the light alone in your own home this year, know that the love of God is with you, and the fellowship of Christ's church still surrounds you and will uphold you. In my sermon today, Waiting in the Dark, we will look together at two very different faith communities who were struggling, as we are today, to hold on to their hope in the midst of challenging times. Much as we struggle, people back then, even during the Babylonian exile 500 years before Jesus, those people found it hard to believe in a God whose miracles were recorded only in their very distant past, in the dusty pages of ancient scripture. And yet they came together during the exile at their Passover tables to remember their great hero Moses and the Exodus from Egypt nearly 1,000 years before. Into their temptation to despair, the great Hebrew prophet Isaiah offered hope in their God, who works for those who wait, one who could be patient with them even if they found it hard to be patient with God. Similarly, the Apostle Paul wrote to the divided church he had planted in Corinth, urging them to believe that God would give them the strength to face whatever their future might hold, not because of their own faith, but because God was faithful and would strengthen them. Today's recorded service also includes some beautiful piano music from Tony Sullivan and a new bell anthem from the Jubilate Bell Quartet, as well as a scripture reading from Mark Lyon and a call to share from Maurice Downey. We also have a fun children's story from Miss Wendy in our separate children's worship. Children are also invited to participate in our live Zoom church school or children's choir from their homes. If you want to connect your child with either of those programs, or if you have a junior or senior high interested in one of our youth groups, you just need to email us at office@uccb.org. Adults can also connect with us for fellowship or learning or service projects via that email as well. If you have a joy or concern you'd like us to lift up in our worship next week, you can email us those needs as well. Finally, just a quick reminder that we have made the hard decision to suspend our indoor prayer meetings for the remainder of 2020 in an attempt to limit our community's potential exposure to the COVID virus. But we do have several outdoor gatherings planned in the near future. Our Advent wreath making this afternoon on November 29th, as well as our Christmas tree lighting on December 6th, and our Christmas Eve worship at the barn on December 24th. You will need to wear a mask and remain at a safe social distance, but you are welcome to join us. Just remember to sign up online. And now, let us unite our hearts in a silent prayer for Christ's peace.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Praying for the coming of God's Messiah gives us hope.
Let us lift up together the light of hope.
Let us pray. Hear our prayers, Good Shepherd. Lead us as your faithful flock. We thank you for coming to the rescue of your people in the past. Stories of your powerful, redeeming love still give us hope. We remember how you once brought your people out of slavery in Egypt. You planted many nations, including ours, giving us rich land and good food to eat. Turn again to look at us today, O God, for we confess that sometimes when we cry out to you in the deep darkness, as we toss and turn at night, you can seem very far away. So hear us when we call to you from out of our daily struggles, from the very real worries we face on earth, because we need you. We need you to be God with us in the here and now. You know how much we need to feel the warmth of your face near us and your strong arms holding us close. So reach out your hand and lend us your strength. Fill us with new life and fresh hope through the grace of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, thank you for the promise of new life that you bring us through your Savior Jesus and through the words of your great prophets and apostles. As we listen today, kindle within us a renewed spirit of hope. Inspire us to lift up your light and share our faith with others who need to feel your strength through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Hebrew scripture reading today is from the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 64, selected verses, 1-9, from the Message translation. Oh, that you would rip open the heavens and come down, make the mountains shudder at your presence, as when a forest catches fire, as when fire makes a pot to boil, to shock your enemies into facing you. Make the nations shake in their boots. You did terrible things we never expected and made the mountains shudder in your presence. Since before time began, no one has ever imagined, no ear heard, no eye seen a God like you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who happily do what is right, who keep a good memory of the way you work. But how angry you've been with us. We've sinned and kept at it so long. Is there any hope for us? Can we be saved? We're all sin infected, sin contaminated. Still, God, you are our Father. We're the clay and you're our potter. All of us are what you made us. Don't be too angry with us, O God. Don't keep a permanent account of wrongdoing. Keep in mind, please, we are your people, all of us. Our epistle reading today is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 1, selected verses 2-9. To the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are called to be saints, together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you are called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. May God add a blessing to the reading of this holy word. Amen.
Will you pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our minds and hearts as we gather to worship you today, may it all be acceptable and even pleasing to you, for you are our strength and our salvation. Amen. Did you get a touch of Holy Bible whiplash from those two readings? They are so different. First, the great prophet Isaiah calls down the wrath of God to shake the mountains and kindle wildfires hot enough to boil water. Then we get to hear these sweet opening words of St. Paul's letter to the church in Corinth. Grace to you and peace from the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you. Well, before we are tempted to lapse into old prejudices against the Hebrew prophets and start to feel all warm and fuzzy about our gentler, kinder Christian New Testament, let me warn you, there is much hope to come from Isaiah and great love offered in his promise of God's divine judgment. And there is an angry sermon to come from Paul in his first letter to the Corinthians. We have to remember that the Corinthian church had become very angry and divided after Paul left over all kinds of petty differences. So before he began to preach at them, he first needed to remind them of his love and of their call to be saints in Christ's church. So remember, before you get to the beautiful poetry so often read in weddings, those verses of 1 Corinthians 13, love is patient and kind, you know, and faith, hope, and love abide, these three. Before all that, you have to muddle through a lot more of 1 Corinthians, beginning with the very next verse after the one that ended our text today. Paul writes, "Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of Jesus, that you be united. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you." You know, we think of 1 Corinthians as a lovely book of the Bible, but for the people of the church there in Corinth to get a personal letter from their beloved founder Paul, you know they knew they were busted. Chloe's people had ratted them out. That's what Paul revealed. So they knew they were in trouble. They were ready, I'm sure, to sit up and listen. One member of our Bible study summed it up like this. He said that when he began playing high school football, he was very worried about messing up, all jumpy about the coach maybe yelling at him. And an older guy on the team took him aside and said, "You know, don't worry when the coach yells at you. You just have to worry when the coach gets very, very quiet." You know, that is the fear of the Lord a good parent or teacher can put into us. When someone loves us, when someone places their hope in us, believes in us, when someone is watching over us closely, there is no worse feeling than knowing we've let them down. Advent is that season where we in the church get reminded that our God is like that. God with us, Emmanuel, is always ready to save us from our own fear, our incompetence, even our evil. And that is also the tiny hope of spark of hope that we can get in scripture like this about the coming of the day of the Lord, because that hope is supposed to be kindled within us on the first Sunday of Advent. It is more than a little unnerving, I think, but the good news here is that our God is one who cares enough to come down to earth and get involved. Our God, like a loving father or mother, like a good coach, like our faithful brother Jesus, doesn't turn away when we do the wrong thing, doesn't just shrug off our habitual mistakes, bad manners, and terrible habits. But our God cares enough to get involved and even to yell at us for our own good, to make us pay attention, sit up straight, you know, do our homework. The truth is, the wrath of God may seem terrible, but there is nothing worse than feeling the vast, dark, yawning absence of God. What St. John of the Cross so famously called the dark night of the soul. Maybe you've known that feeling before. The feeling that no one hears your prayer, no one cares or notices whether we live or die. But Scripture warns us that that way leads to despair and calls us out of that darkness into the light. A church member once told me of a dark moment like that in his neighbor's life when there was a winter storm and one of those sudden power outages. When the older man next door to him, a widower, had been going down his basement stairs at first, you know, just to check on the circuit breakers, he had lost his balance and fell to the bottom, and he lost his flashlight on the way. So for hours and hours, he lay there in the pitch darkness, in pain, praying for help. His hope was in God, but also a slight flicker of hope for his neighbor, our church member, because they had this standing agreement that he would check on him anytime the porch light got left on during the day. It was their special signal. But now in a power outage, of course it wouldn't work. So, in the darkness, waiting, the neighbor wondered what would happen. Well, sure enough, the church member next door decided that since the light literally couldn't shine in the darkness with no power in town, he went over to his neighbor's house to knock on the door. Getting no answer, he looked in a window and knocked again, still getting no answer. He went around to the other side. Giving up, he finally called 911. He told me that in that moment he was praying and agonizing over it, hoping it was a false alarm, but, you know, also hoping the call was needed because he didn't want to get his neighbor angry with him and waste the time of first responders during a genuine community crisis. Well, it turns out the neighbor was badly injured in the fall down the stairs, and after a long night of praying in the dark, he believed that that 911 call was what saved his life. Angels and saints come in many forms. Saints of Christ's Church are usually very ordinary heroes. It's just we have to remember to focus on what matters, love of our neighbor, walking in God's way, and caring for the least of these, our brothers and sisters in need. So this is the kind of covenant faithfulness that the prophet Isaiah is calling for God to come down to earth and show God's love for his people, those people in captivity who were hurting, very deep in need, being taunted by their enemies. In hard times like these, even, that we're going through today, don't we wish for the same? For an end to the pandemic, for this invisible killer virus to be eradicated, for a return to our national health and prosperity, for an end to the political divisions that have been tearing us all apart, for God's will and way to be made clear and visible to all, for God to be our true vision and our guide. That's why I think God's that fiery image in Isaiah of God's transformative action is so powerful. We do not so much see our God as see what our God does and what our God has done. Like the spark kindling of fire and causing a pot to boil, it often happens gradually over time, so it can be hard to be patient and to wait, to acknowledge what is happening in a spiritual realm that we can't exactly see. For the Hebrew people, you know, I've often reminded you, they were the laughingstock of the ancient world, especially there in captivity in Babylon. Their God just seemed weak and useless. I mean, think about it from the Babylonian perspective. They had no statues or images. Who could say this Yahweh even existed? The Babylonians had enormous stone lions at their gates, and Marduk, their god, had a pet dragon at his side. Their symbols were enormous, impressive, shiny, powerful, clearly visible, and deadly real. The simple Israelites believed in this weird, invisible god who appeared to them like wind in the desert to guide them and draw them together in a holy covenant of love. Mutual affection. Oh, brother, compared to real power, the power of armies and emperors, the wealth of nations, they looked silly. And yet, we know, as people of faith, it only takes a spark to get a fire going, as the hymn says. The smallest breath of God, one tiny whisper of inner wisdom, can inspire great things, saving things even, when we pay attention to what is happening in the dark and offer a little light of hope. It can mean all the world to the person sitting alone, waiting in the dark. It is what it means to be the Church of Jesus Christ, I would say. It's why I, like Paul, so often genuinely say, I thank God for every one of you. I really mean it. I am dazzled by our church, by your generosity, your goodness. In the midst of so much bad news out in the world, I want you to know your kindness gives me hope. Another story that was shared with me recently by a member in our church was about someone who also had a neighbor in need, in distress. But the way it was noticed was, it was about a different sort of darkness. It was at a holiday party that the neighbor's distress was noticed. It was just like something in her eyes and her tone of voice that signaled that something wasn't quite right. So in much the same way, there was a small follow-up a caring neighbor, a little knock on the door the next day. Our member had just stopped by to be still and notice her neighbor's hidden pain, to look deeply into her eyes and to ask that one simple question, are you okay? And the most important part, I guess, is that she stayed to listen to the answer. And after that, came a gentle invitation just to come to church, to come out of the lonely place and into the light of hope. Change didn't happen overnight, but now, several years later, we can celebrate that the pot has come to a full boil. The light and warmth of God has become real for the friend and neighbor. Hope has been restored and God has been made visible to all in a shining, bright, beautiful way in her life and in our community. People of faith, know that we are still called to be saints of Christ's church, no less than the people of Corinth so many ages ago. We are called to be peacemakers, to be unifiers. Let us lift up the light of hope every chance we get. Let us make God's love visible and real everywhere we go.
Friends, as we enter into our time of prayer, we want to remind you that we are not doing the service live, so these people have let us know their prayer requests in advance. We would invite you to email us at office@uccb.org if you have joys or concerns for next week as well. So as we come into our time of prayer, we are praying for all of those who are most affected by COVID right now, especially for those who will be missing lost loved ones over the holidays. We continue to pray for our medical personnel, first responders, and frontline workers, as well as parents and teachers, as schools have closed again in many places. And for those awaiting test results or newly diagnosed with COVID, we are especially praying this week for Jillian, Edgar, and their family as Edgar recovers from COVID, and for Donna's brother-in-law, Gene, and his wife, Judy, as Gene was newly diagnosed as well. We pray for the homeless in our own community and surrounding areas, as well as refugees around the world as COVID continues to spread and as cold weather will soon be upon us, as well as for those who are recovering from natural disasters throughout our nation and the world. We pray for all of those continuing to grieve dear ones, for Ruth, Susan, and Peter, David and his family, and a few of our church family members who are grieving the deaths of beloved four-legged family members over these last few weeks as well. We are lifting up prayers for all of those of you in our church family and beyond who are in an unsettled place in life right now, who are struggling whether with financial issues or unemployment or mental health issues, addictions, or domestic violence. We are lifting up special prayers today for Nikki, who has a job interview this week, that all goes well. We also are praying for those recovering from recent surgeries or hospital stays, like Donna, who is now home, Kim and Sandy, who is in PT after a recent hospital stay too. We are inviting your prayers for all of those who are going through cancer treatments, for Kim, Brian, Manuel, Gavin, Nick, Susan, Tommy, Rocky, Haley, and Jen. And we continue to pray for Carol and Joan, who are in hospice care. And we lift up prayers for all of our caregivers and their loved ones in need of special care right now. So we lift up prayers today for Shonda and Kathy, for Bill and Mary Lou, for Linda and Ed, Bob and Janet, George and Nancy, for Marion, Dan, Larry, John, Valerie, for Barbara, Mary, and Peggy as well. And we are lifting up prayers this weekend after this past holiday, Thanksgiving, for safe travels for all of those who are on the road and for our returning college students working toward the end of their semesters as well. We do have some joys that we wish to lift up today too. We are lifting up joys for those who are able to be with family and friends for Thanksgiving, whether in person or through the wonders of technology. We are lifting up gratitude for our gifted church quilt fairy again, who is providing our Advent wall hangings for us. We lift up the joy of our bell choir members and our music director, Tony, for sharing their gifts for today's worship. And for our youth fellowship members and advisors who were able to share some gifts and resources this last week on behalf of those who use the services of Loaves and Fishes Hospitality House by providing bagged lunches, desserts, and blessing bags. And now, friends, we know that God also hears the concerns and the joys that are lying in the silence of our hearts this day as well. But now will you join your hearts and your souls in the spirit of prayer with me? Holy One, we thank you for your faithfulness, for your beloved ones from generation to generation, even unto us today. We thank you that as we lift up these prayers to you today and each week, that we believe you know and hear and are already at work in the lives of those who need to know your strength, healing, and love, and in those places in our nation and our world that are broken and in need of wholeness. God, for those who are finding today a day of particular difficulty and challenge, whether due to illness in mind, body, or spirit, or loneliness, or for other reasons we may never know or understand, we pray they might know your presence and care as close to them as their own breath. We pray for those who do not know where they will find shelter, their next meal, or safety in the days ahead, that with your power working through your servants in this world, relief, rebuilding, and hope will not be far away. During this time, God, as we feel both like we are rushing and busy and stressed, we may also feel like we are a bit stalled, like we aren't quite sure what it is that we can do to help move toward the building up of your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. And now we enter into a season of increased darkness, the Advent season, a time of waiting, of reflection and repentance, as we hold fast to your promise of one who brings new light and hope into the world. God, grant us patience and forgive us for the ways we have failed to reach out when there was opportunity, to lift up our voices when we had the chance for those in need of what we take for granted, to share your love with others in small ways, whether through a kind word in the checkout line or an extra moment shared with someone who needed a listening ear. Help us to feel the light of your grace and to see those opportunities more readily and clearly in the days ahead. Like our ancestors who came before us, we sometimes have difficulty seeing you at work in our lives each day, God. Help to attune us in a new way to your presence in action, to those moments when we know just what to say and do as your children with the help of your work in us, to the ways that you call us to use our gifts in service to you and your way of love and justice in the world. As individuals and in community, we strive to grow in our faith and love of you. So may we know the ways that we can come together to accept the challenge to be your best people for the world, to grow and to change. Through the power of your Holy Spirit and following the example of Jesus Christ, may we be those who lift up the light of your hope for those both near and far as we enter into this Advent season and into all the seasons loaned to us ahead. We pray this in your most holy name. Amen.
This is Maurice Downey. My wife Kim and I have been members of the congregation for 25 years now. Kind of surprising to me, but it's true. Why do I love my church? It may sound kind of cliche, but it really is the people. There's a phrase that we use around the church a lot. It's a church family. And this really is a family. We have mother and father figures, we have brothers and sisters, and we have people that genuinely care about each other. And that is something that's pretty special in today's world. And we know this. I had the virus earlier this year, and Kim, with some recent medical challenges that she's had, so many people have reached out to us just to show they care, see how we're doing, make sure we're doing okay. And the genuine outpouring of just love and concern is kind of humbling, and we really appreciate it. So being a part of the family is very special. So why do I give to this church? Well, giving to this church is one of the things that, for me personally, all the different ways that you give to other organizations or to other charities, this is one where you actually see where your money goes. You see the new carpet, you feel the air conditioning and you feel the heat, thankfully. You see the new choir robes and you hear the new organ or the updates to the organ. And you hear people that come to the church, like Brookfield Social Services, that thank us for all the work that we do for them and giving to them for the Brookfield Pantry and other things. Myself, I've had the opportunity to also be on some of the mission trips with our youth to see how they, are growing and learning how to care for other people, and that's very special, to see. So the generosity of this family makes all of this possible, and I feel, blessed to be part of the family to contribute to that. So generosity is appreciated, and we appreciate your continued giving.
people of faith, may the Holy Spirit kindle a fresh spark of hope within you. May the love of God begin to warm your heart and lift your spirits. And may the peace of Christ fill you to overflowing, so that you may begin to pass the peace widely, extravagantly, recklessly even. May your joy spread like a wildfire that ignites your family, your friends, and every soul your life touches.